The first year homework is for Tuesday.
Yes.
We were wondering if we could push it a little because we have the CSAT test on Tuesday.
We have two more homeworks and a lot of work.
Yeah.
And a lot of exams. And a lot of practice.
I would complain a bit more with the with QFT because no, since so the point is that I know that we have the exam, but you don't we don't have GR lectures next week, so it's the only thing that you have.
Wait,
no, I'm not around. So I already thought about this, but since I said okay, I'm not teaching, I thought to leave. I mean, try your best in the sense if there will be some excuse. So next week there are no, but if you look at the program, it's already like this. Next week there will be no GR lectures, there will only be the tutorial on Wednesday, actually. Right? Yes, so the next lecture will be the following Tuesday, so in.
Yeah. You say they were saying this, sending this your lecture notes.
Yes. Okay. If I don't remind me, please.
Okay.
Okay. Any question?
Yes.
Yes.
A couple of questions. When you define like the metric on the search field. The coordinate on the search field metric is the time of which observer? Of who?
Well, this is in general it's an ill-defined question, no?
Mm-hmm.
So don't because the
mm-hmm.
in general it's just a coordinate and it's
okay.
Not obvious. So one can discuss, for example, very far away from the black hole,
mm-hmm.
since the metric becomes Minkowskian, it
mm-hmm.
coincides with the clock of inertial observers far away.
Okay.
For the rest, it's ill-defined. So in general, the time in the metric does not correspond to anything,
okay.
or does not correspond to any
observer.
To any observer.
And when we want to compute
the also, no, just to tell you, because already, so the fact that the G00 component of the metric is different from zero. So,
mm-hmm.
even, so imagine that, for example, you decide to take an observer which is at fixed radius theta and phi,
mm-hmm.
Which of course is not a geodesic motion, but it's an observer.
Mm-hmm.
Still, for that observer, d tau squared is related to dt squared
mm-hmm.
by the metric. So, it, not
mm-hmm.
even for that observer coincides.
Mm-hmm.
With time, so
mm-hmm.
so you know the yes.
So for example, I was thinking, you want to parameterize, let's say the time of any point of the space with the time that appears in the metric, because I can do that. I can define like the time at any point. Which with parameter t, which appears in the metric. I was thinking, comparing with whom I am. If I am computing the time, the proper time, of a distance from the center at a distance r, but with the parameter t, then
with the sorry, the only physical things is the. Tau, no?
Uh-huh.
So the proper time, time of order. So if you tell me what is the motion of an observer in this geometry,
mm-hmm.
its proper time is the integral of the metric along the curve.
Mm-hmm.
All the rest is not very well defined, but no, maybe I.
Mm-hmm.
What is the question?
If I want to compute the proper time at a certain geodesic, but I want to relate this proper time with respect to a parameter, like for example,
yeah,
the time.
You can. Yeah.
That time is the like the one of an observer at the infinite.
Be careful.
So that is a function of t. Like,
The suggestion is always that you have to think about some physical mechanism to signal. It's a bit too cheap, but in a sense, it's a bit too cheap to say that this is the proper time of a faraway observer. Sometimes it may work, but the point is that if for example if you are thinking about so you have the object and you have some observer doing some motion around and you are comparing with somebody at infinity. Mm-hmm. Well, what you know is that this variable here coincides with the proper time, but does not mean much here, no? Because here G00 is different from zero. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have some argument to send signal to this observer, it might work. In general, I would not. So usually, the typical problem is, for example, I can ask, I don't know, if I send signal from an observer here to an observer there, I can ask what is the redshift, mm-hmm. I can ask these kind of things. But don't try to read too much from the form of the coordinates. The coordinates are just labels, mm-hmm. and, they are just labels. It turns out that if I go far away, this t becomes the proper time of an observer at infinity, but more than this, I will not. I will not push.
Okay.
Any other question? Okay. So what I want to do today is to start studying the spiral geometry closer to this spiral radius. So let me write the metric and let me forget about the angular coordinates. So I for most of this lecture I will forget about the angular coordinates, which of course you can add, but basically I'm more interested in radial motion. Okay. So the first thing is let me who is the next? Guillermo, you are the next. Can you the first thing that we are interested in knowing basically what happens at the spatial radius. So the first thing that comes to your mind is to look at the light cone. Okay, the light cone will tell me whether, of course, all trajectories which are time-like are inside the light cone, so it's very useful to know what the light cone is doing. So what is the light cone doing in this? I'm dropping the angular coordinates. This means that I'm looking only at radial motion. Okay, so it's a two-dimensional problem. So let's look at what is the light cone.
Okay, so light should satisfy this?
Exactly.
So from here I can put I pass this to the other. And then I have
Yes.
I can integrate. Well, take the square root and integrate them.
Yeah, but that's okay. So I'm interested in locally what is you can of course you can integrate, but I'm interested in what is in Minkowski. Yeah. If I calculate the same thing in Minkowski, this is one, so I always get something which in TR is always something at 45 degrees, yeah. The usual light cone. Indeed, yeah. Far away from the black hole, you have the 45 black hole, no? So I want to know what happens if I go closer to the black hole.
Okay. Okay, let me know. Yeah, if I go, so I can, this is the quantity.
Yes, indeed.
That we want, so, I don't know, closer to r equals 2gn.
Yes, what happens?
So that's close to zero? Zero?
Go, yeah, this goes to zero.
Yeah, this goes to zero.
Yeah, so this. So let's imagine that this is the spatial reducer. Yeah, so the question is, what happens to this icon? Does it close? Does it open as I go to the black hole?
It turns out that since that is an infinite, it should go to a straight line.
Yes. So can you draw as I go closer and closer, what happens to the icon?
Okay. It's narrow.
Good, very good. Very good. Until it closes completely.
Yeah, it looks like lamp.
Yes, very good. So, is it clear? So, this is the first. What does it mean this try to draw a time like trajectory. So, now we're not looking at geodesics anymore. We forget about geodesics. We take a generic motion, but of course, any motion must be time like. Okay? So, can you draw any time like observer which is going towards the black hole? Okay. So what is so since you have the light cone, you know that it must satisfy some.
Yeah, it would look like something like this. Probably.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, very good. Very good. You see, already from the knowledge of the light cone, I know that since any motion which is time-like must remain inside the light cone, it means that I am bound to be asymptotic to the horizon, but of course I can never. I mean, in this picture, I can never cross this line, no, because the closer I get, the more I have to move inside the light cone, which is exactly closed at the horizon. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Okay, so this is already the first. So now one conclusion that one can draw, looking at this. But it turns out not to be correct, is that you might imagine this looks like saying that an observer tries to enter the black hole, but actually does not succeed, and it's sort of staying outside the horizon forever. Okay? I call horizon this vanishing radius, I also call it horizon for reasons that would become clear. So it seems that you cannot cross it. It seems that that you are staying outside forever. Okay. So this is not actually the case, and one way to see it is the following. So what is it now? What is the physical question that you want to ask? Yes.
What about the other solution from the square root?
So yeah, the solution is like this, and it corresponds to the two directions. Okay. Yes. Yeah, it's a good question because. As I'm going to explain now, when I change coordinates, these two solutions will be asymmetric. In a sense, now it's just minus, but the two directions of the light cone, ingoing and outgoing, they will become different. So, but in this case, it just corresponds to the two directions. Okay, so the question that we want to ask is whether an observer crosses or not the line r equal to rs. So how do we answer this question? Exactly. So the correct question, coming back to also to Jorge's question, so the coordinate independent question is what happens to the proper time of this observer, okay? So whether the fact that it goes to t equal to plus infinity does not mean much, because again, coordinates are just names that we give to points on the black. So the physically coordinate independent question is whether it takes a finite or infinite proper time to cross the horizon. So let me, so the answer is that it takes a finite proper time, and this is, let me, for example, do it in this way. Let me consider a geodesic. Again, this is more general than this, but in particular, I can also take somebody that is falling without any additional force, which is falling towards the black hole. Okay, so this would be a geodesic motion. In particular, it would be a geodesic with zero angular momentum, because it's just falling in the center, so there is no motion in the angular coordinates. Okay, so in this case, one can look at the formulas we are using the other time. So I just used the conservation that we found. So we have the kinetic energy in the radial direction, and then there is the potential. Now it's simpler because there is no angular motion, so there is no angular momentum. So if you look at your notes, you will find that this is the equation. Okay, there is no L, and now you see that everything is pretty transparent. In a sense, this is the same as some particle moving in a one-dimensional potential, and this one-dimensional potential is just like this. It's just, apart from a constant, is 1 over r. Okay. This is the potential, it's a function of r, and this is r. Okay. So now, what are we asking to this system? So this is we have to decide the energy. If the energy is higher than 1, it means that we are considering some particle with energy higher than the asymptotic value. This means that it's a particle that came from infinity, or can go to infinity, because the energy is higher than the binding energy. Okay. Or otherwise, I can take a particle with an energy which is smaller than the asymptotic value. This means that it's a particle that started at a certain point. So it's. But this does not. So what we're interested in is to understand whether it takes a finite or infinite time to cross the point r equal to gm. But you see, nothing happens, because now this system is already written in terms of the proper time. So it's not that you have to think about, so the time variable of this problem is exactly the proper time, the one you are interested in. You see, there is nothing can go to infinity, no? So it's just a one-dimensional system. If it starts here, for example, with zero velocity, it will reach in a finite amount of time, it will go to close to r equal to zero. Okay. So there is no divergence here, it's a very simple mechanical problem, and everything is finite because nothing happens at r equal to 2 gm. Okay. So whatever you calculate is always finite. Okay. So we can calculate for a particular case, but what is important is that since it is written in terms of the proper time, it's evident that nothing happens at the horizon. Okay, so what we understand is that although in these coordinates it seems that you cannot cross the horizon, actually just an artifact of the choice of coordinates. So it's telling you that in a finite proper time you reach t equal to plus infinity. Okay. Is it clear? So the formula is, I mean, the algebra is very, very easy. So it's just that one has to familiarize with what we're talking about, no? So these two put together tells you that, of course, the fact that it's finite for a geodesic implies that it will be finite also for any motion. Okay, so there is no difference. Of course, the algebra will be different, but it's already clear from here that you can reach the horizon in a finite proper time. Putting these together with these, we also learn another thing, which actually is consistent to with something that we studied last time. So imagine that now Guillermo trajectory is somebody that is falling towards the black hole, and he sends signals to infinity at a regular pace, meaning with a proper clock, every second he sends a signal. Okay. Now, since the proper time to cross the horizon is finite, so the guy will send out a finite number of pulses. Okay. On the other hand, in these coordinates, this process will go on forever. Like forever in the sense, in the t coordinate, it goes. Okay, there's nothing. So this will go on at larger and larger t. Okay. But this should not be counted as a surprise. In a sense, if Jorge is an observer at infinity, this means that the number of pulses he receives is finite, but it takes more and more time for the next pulse to arrive, which is compatible with the fact that, as we saw last time, the redshift, if I calculate the redshift of an object, of a photon, for example, sent close to the horizon to infinity, this redshift goes to infinity as the source gets closer and closer to the horizon. Okay, and this is compatible with the fact that actually you see that the pulses have become rarer and rarer because in a finite proper time one has to emit, this finite number of pulses is diluted over an infinite time. Coordinate. Time coordinate, I mean t, which is the.
So is this coordinate small t and small r is a coordinate of this guy at infinity?
This is his question. Yeah. I was cautious because you now that we have a well-defined setup, in a sense, now I'm asking what is the time that somebody at infinity will receive the signal. Okay. Now you see that since the metric does not depend on t, okay, you should solve for light rays coming out here. You should solve the problem, what you will find. So what I'm saying is that you cannot just read the coordinate t at which a pulse is emitted. This will not, in general, correspond to the if I calculate the distance in t between this signal and this signal, yeah, it's not obvious that this will coincide with the time elapsed for an observer at infinity, because of course this would be emitted to the horizon, so it will take a bit more time to go out. Yeah. So that's why I'm saying you should not read t and say t means the time measured at infinity. Still, from this picture, it's clear that if I think about an observer at infinity, the elapsed time between one pulse and the other is becoming longer and longer because the coordinate t goes to infinity and there is a finite. Again, to answer this question, you always have to think about what is the physical problem. So it's not correct to say that these coordinates coincide with time and radius for an observer at infinity locally. In a sense, if I'm very far away, this is boils down to the Minkowski metric, and then there t and r coincide. But you should not think about these automatically as the proper time of an observer at infinity, no?
But I can show that this is an accelerated coordinate. This can be the coordinate of an accelerated observer. Is that possible?
So what do you want to do? What does it mean by the
I saw it somewhere that this t and this r, I can show it that this is this can coincide with the coordinates of an accelerated observer.
Are you sure that you are thinking about this geometry? Or maybe
I'm not sure.
It depends on what you want to say. For example, it is true that if I take an observer which is moving in the time direction at fixed r theta and phi, yes, this is an accelerated motion. It's not a geodesic.
Yes.
But it's not that. I don't know if it is. I wonder whether you are thinking about the Ringler space.
Yes, I'm thinking
in a constant. Yeah. It's not this kind of geometry. This is just a, you will have an exercise about this, but anyway, it's Minkowski space written in coordinates which are basically co-moving with an observer with constant acceleration. Okay? But there is no black hole there, it's just Minkowski. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, just to... okay, well, let me do a very simple example just to... which is not physically motivated, but just to understand what kind of subtlety can arise in using a certain coordinate. Let me consider, this is just an example, just a mathematical. So imagine that I give you a metric, okay, is minus 1 over t to the 4th dt squared plus dx squared in two dimension. Okay. Now, when you look at this metric, what you may wonder is what happens for t equal to 0. Because you see, it's kind of similar to these problems. So at t equal to 0, this becomes infinity in the same way as this goes to infinity. So it seems that something is wrong at t equal to 0.
And you can change another coordinate?
Yes, which coordinate?
No,
well, no, but anyway, it's always a good idea to change coordinates. So to make things completely transparent, you can just choose another coordinate, t prime, which is 1 over t. Okay, because in this case, dt squared, well, dt prime squared is just dt over t squared. Okay, which correspond to this. So you see, written in this coordinate, this is just Minkowski space. Right? Which tells you two things, which to be reminded. First of all, that we should not have worried about t equal to 0, because actually, it's true that it's a strange place, but it corresponds to t prime equal to infinity. So it is just something that will never be reached in a fine parameter. Okay. So apart that it's a regular point, but it's infinity. So it's in infinity in the sense that geodesics will reach there in an infinite amount of proper time. Okay. So we should not have worried about that, but we should have worried about t equal to infinity, because t equal to infinity, although here I was not worried about that, corresponds to t prime equal to 0. So in a similar way, I mean just mathematically, but there is a similarity with that, because although you did maybe looking at thinking about this as time, you didn't think about it. In this example, you reach t equal to plus infinity, like it happens in this case, in a finite amount of proper time, because this is just the origin of Minkowski space, okay. Which means that, of course, the space-time is not complete. So when I write this, of course, I'm assuming that t is positive. But actually, this does not cover the whole space, because I can reach t equal to plus infinity in a finite proper time, like in this example. And then I have to tell how to proceed. So it's just what I did is something trivial as saying that, for example, imagine that I want to describe the blackboard and I use a coordinate which diverges on this line. Okay, so I use x, but x diverges here. It's just that I use a stupid coordinate. In a sense, it's my fault that I decided here is plus infinity, so I can do it, but nobody prevents a line in a fine parameter to cross, and then you have to explain what happens afterwards. And the same happens, well, very clearly here, but also here, because you see, we proved that in a finite proper time, you reach coordinate t equal to plus infinity. Okay, any question?
Who is that tank?
Who is holding that?
Who? Yeah, you want
to. Sorry, say again?
like, I don't know, in relativity, I always confused who is, like, who is the holder of that block? I mean.
Yeah, but this is the wrong question. So you should think about coordinates just as labels. Mm-hmm. So it's not like a special relativity in which they correspond to some clock of some observer, no? Mm-hmm. This interpretation holds in some regime, but in general, so look at this. For sufficiently, if you try to answer this question, notice that this becomes positive at a certain point. So it's better that this does not correspond to time of anything. So it's just a name that you give to... It's just names that you give to the point manifold. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, of course, you know, you try to use coordinates, so the fact that this is nice that far away it becomes the time of Minkowski. Mm-hmm. But, once you reach a regime in which the geometry is very far from Minkowski, you cannot ask too much. You cannot ask the geometry to be Minkowskian while you're not in Minkowski. No?
I'm not sure what the question is, I'm just confused. The whole discussion is about, but we should not refer to T as the time of anything. But we still refer to R as the radius. So those R coins have some radius.
Well, it corresponds. Good question. If I remind you that the geometry reads like this. So these are, it has at least one interpretation, which is the radius of the corresponding sphere. So if you want, when I say R, it means that if I stop there at that R and I go around measuring the surface of the sphere, I get 4 pi R squared. So R is the radius of the sphere, meaning what I can get looking at the surface. Of course, it does not, since the metric is not triggering the radial direction, this may not, will not, have also the interpretation of distance from the center, but it has the interpretation of radius of the sphere. Okay, it's a very good question. So when I this axis, you can think about the axis of radius of the sphere. Okay, so this has a well defined geometrical meaning. Okay,
isn't that the radius of the manifold, which has a singularity in R equals
zero? No. For various reasons. I don't know what you have in mind when you look at this, but now maybe it will become more clear. But notice that not only R is not the distance from the center, but even the radius will change meaning once you cross the Schwarzschild radius. Okay? No? So you should not. It's completely. This is not just like some sort of small deformation of Minkowski. It's not only that this function tells you that the radius is not really R, but there is a factor of 2. So this completely changed meaning. Okay. So yeah, we're going to this is the point of the lesson. So we're going to explore what happens at this when you cross the horizon. To answer your question, there is no well-defined notion of distance from the center in the geometry. There is really no center in some sense. Maybe it will be kind of more clear, but in a sense, there is a center in the sense that it's foliated in there are spheres with radius R, but there is no point that I can call the center.
Mm-hmm. Can you make like can you change your coordinates to maybe make it R, something?
Yeah.
I'm
afraid that you asked the wrong question because I'm going to change the coordinates at least 5 times. this is exactly what we're going to do. So let's try to gather more intuition changing the coordinates. Okay, so here it was very useful. Now, of course, this was simple because it was Minkowski space, but we can improve. Okay, let's see if we get some information using our coordinates. So,
One coordinate which is very useful are the so-called tortoise coordinates. And the idea is very simple. The idea is to use this expression, okay, and to insist. So here I'm using very strange coordinates for which the light cone closes. Okay, so one can decide. So it seems that one can redefine the radial coordinates in such a way that the light cone stays open. Okay. Of course, this does not change the fact that, as Julian is saying, so R is the only one with the interpretation of the radius of the sphere. So I can decide to use another radial variable. Of course, if I want to know the radius, I have to go back to R. So I use this, and I integrate in R. So what I'm saying is the following. So I'm doing exactly the integral that Guillermo was doing. So I integrate this. So this corresponds, if you want, to delta t. So I'm looking at the light cone, and I insist that the light cone remains at 45 degrees. So I do this integral. This integral, if you do it, it gives R plus 2gm log of R over 2gm minus 1. Okay, so this is just a result. There is a constant, of course. So it's an integral up to R. Okay. So this is a function of R, and I define this to be R star. So what did I do? I just decide if I call this object the new radial variable, then using R star and T, now the light cone is very simple. It is delta T, apart from the constant, delta t is equal to delta r star. Okay? So I chose coordinates such that the light cone now is always open. It stays like this forever. Okay, the variable r star. Let me write what is the metric in these coordinates. Side. Okay, how do I get this? Well, I can do the change of coordinates, but it's already obvious because I didn't touch time. Okay, so I have the same object as before. Okay. But by subtraction in this metric, the light cone should be at 45 degrees. So it means that when I put dx squared equal to 0, I must be the same as in Minkowski. Okay. Of course, you can check that given this relation, this follows. Notice here R appears. R is just a function of R star. Okay. I cannot invert analytically this expression, but okay, at least formally, it's just this. So this follow the metric has some advantage. Well, for sure it has the advantage that, for example, when I look at the light cone, it's just trivial. It's like this conformally flat, so it's just like Minkowski. Of course, I didn't solve much because now where is the horizon? Well, the horizon is r equal to 2gm, but the log goes to minus infinity at this point. So what I did, I just chose another coordinate system in which, yes, it's true that the light cone stays open, but now the sparsity radius of the horizon is at minus infinity.
Like shifting the horizon.
Yeah, so the coordinate name of the horizon, before it was r equal to gm, yes. Now is r star equal to minus infinity. It's just that, again, it's always the coordinate name that I give to... good. Notice that now in these coordinates it's even more clear that if I want to reach the horizon, I have to go to t equal to plus infinity, because I have to. I mean, now the causal structure is like in Minkowski. So if I ask you, I have to get to r star equal to minus infinity. Of course, from a finite radius, it takes an infinite amount of t. But again, an infinite amount of t, which, since the relation between t and the proper time involves this, this is still compatible with the fact that it takes a finite proper time to get to the horizon. Okay, so, of course, the physics is always... Okay, let me change the coordinate once again. To use what I want to do in some sense is to find coordinates which follow the, so I want to see what happens to an ingoing light ray, okay, because in these coordinates an ingoing light ray just goes to r star equal to minus infinity, t equal to plus infinity. But I don't know what happens afterwards. Okay, so I define these two coordinates v and u, which are just the linear combination of notice that if I take an ingoing light ray. Ingoing means that t increases and r star go to minus infinity. So I'm just saying the following, that if I give you a trajectory with constant t, it means that it's a trajectory which for large t, so for t going to plus infinity, r star go to minus infinity. Okay. So this will be a null geodesic ingoing. If you do the same with the variable u, you will find a null geodesic outgoing. Yeah, so then I can define what they're called Eddington Finkelstein coordinates. Yeah, this is, or just to give you a flavor, somebody asked last time if there is a systematic procedure to understand how to get rid of whether it's a singularity or not. Just to give you the flavor of how difficult is the problem, already for this super simple geometry, which is, I mean, it's very simple, it took many years to find the proper coordinate system, which is not this one, it's the one that I'm introducing next. And it was introduced in 1965. Okay, so it took, this was given in 1919, so it took 50 years to understand. There is no systematic procedure, so you must be, you have to try. Eddington Finkelstein means using V and R as coordinates. And the metric is given by, so I start with this metric. Notice that V basically is a linear combination of these. Okay, so I can write, I don't want to use t anymore, so I write dt squared as d of V minus r star. Okay, and what I get is this. So, well, you can check the algebra, it's quite simple. So you are left, and notice that I went back to the coordinate r, because, well, you see what happens. So what you get, you get dv dr star, but with this object in front, and this differential is equal to dr. It's just a very simple algebra. So what's new about this metric? Well, a good thing, okay, let's check one thing. So we wanted that v equal to constant should correspond to a light ray, because v equal to constant correspond to t equal to minus r star plus a constant, and in these coordinates, lines at 45 degrees are light rays. This is okay, actually, because you see, if you look for d squared equal to zero, one solution is dv equal to zero, which means v equal to constant. Okay? Now you see what is good about these coordinates. What is good is that at the horizon now, so what is bad is that, okay, we are not so used to use coordinates which are null. So v, I don't know, now interpretation becomes a little more difficult because v is neither time nor space. It's really a null trajectory. Right? It's not, nothing forbids to use this. The advantage is that at the horizon, this goes away, but this is completely regular. So you see the metric at the horizon becomes off-diagonal, but finite. There is nothing is blowing up, nothing is, so it's a finite 0, 1, 1, 0. Of course, it may be disturbing that it's off diagonal, but I mean, to the extent of proving that there's no singularity, nothing is blowing up, everything is regular, it's pretty good. Okay. So let me. I leave this because maybe we need it later. So this is the definition of the Tolle's coordinates. Defined like this. Let me look at what happens at the light cone in these coordinates. So I always do the same. So I take r. Now I'm back to this variable, to this radial variable, not one star. And I want to draw the light cone. Well, and I use here the coordinate v. So if I'm far away, now of course these coordinates are not Minkowski and far away. So even far away, I do not go back to the Minkowski and geometry, but okay. So far away, the light cone, it is like this. Because, okay, v equal to constant is null. Okay, so this is one part of the light cone. Now you see that now is what you were asking, no? So now, it's not so easy as to get plus or minus something, because it's not there is no symmetry between. So I have to solve. So I get this solution, and the other solution you get basically dv in dr equal to the inverse of this. Yes, so let me write it here. Yes, so if I ask. I'm doing the same as what Guillermo did at the beginning, but in these coordinates. And what I get is that either I get 0, which is this, or I get 2, 1 minus 2gm over r to the minus 1, which is just the solution of this. Now, far away, this is positive, so it's like this. Okay, apart from this. And this is the light bulb. So, as I go closer to the horizon, what happens? For r equal to 2gm, this goes to infinity. Okay. So, but we're talking about this branch, because this is always this. So what happens is in this coordinate is that the light cone becomes like this. So now it's a bit more clear what happens. In a sense, you see that, well, first of all, we understand that, as it will be even more clear afterwards, that the horizon is null. So in this sense, in our mind, maybe the horizon is a space-like, it corresponds to a given radius, so it looks like just a two-dimensional surface, but with human geometry. With so if I live on this sphere, I expect to live on a Euclidean sphere with like a space sphere. On the other hand, you see, the horizon is null. The horizon corresponds to a null geometry. And another thing that I understand is that, you see, if I follow a geodesic, or whatever, I follow, sorry, a time-like path, so you must be inside the Lycon, so I'm doing the same that we were doing here at the beginning, so I have to remain inside, but you see that when I cross, when I get closer to the horizon, here nothing happens, I don't go to infinity, okay, because the Lycon is not closing, but it's tilted, and once you go even, I draw it here, but when you are inside, it's even worse, because now the Lycon is like this. Because this changes sign. Okay. So the bottom line is that once you are across this line, your future, so the future Lycon, points towards smaller radii. Okay. So this that's why I told you that it's not so trivial to see what is the implication of this geometry beyond the Schwarzschild radius. Because actually, once you cross the Schwarzschild radius, you should think about the radial variable as a time variable. Okay. So your future, so if you cross the Schwarzschild radius, your future, meaning your forward Lycon, points towards smaller r. Okay. So this also means that you are bound to hit the singularity, because your future is r equal to zero. Okay. And there is no way to, I mean, you can also calculate, I think it's one of the problems. So there is a finite amount of proper time that you survive inside this black hole. So there is a finite maximum proper time that you can survive until you hit the singularity. Okay. So you see, once you cross the Hubble radius, the Schwarzschild radius, the radial variable in some sense becomes the time variable, and r equal to zero is some sort of future singularity, no? Because it's I mean, we tend to think it as a place, but it's more like a time. In a sense, it's I know that everything is clear. No, it's a bit disturbing. Now it will become even more disturbing, if possible. How I can make it more disturbing? Yes, I make it more disturbing here. Okay. Okay. Until now is disturbing, but in a good sense. Now I'm going to tell you something which is disturbing in the bad sense, in the following sense. What I'm going to say now, it is true for this geometry, but as we will discuss at the end, it's an artifact of the symmetries that we are imposing. Okay. I explain in what sense. So here, I mean, these are the words that the fact that when you cross the event horizon, you cannot come back, and your future is the singularity. So there is no way to come back to infinity. So you cannot come back to me. So here there is somebody, Minkowski. You crossed, your future is at even smaller radii. There is no way to come back. Okay, this makes sense. Unfortunately, we built this geometry imposing that there is a time reverse asymmetry. Of course, this is just imagination, because an astrophysical black hole will form at a certain point. Okay. So we imposed a very large symmetry, but does not correspond to a physical situation. Anyway, okay, this is a solution, so we can study the solution. But we should not be surprised that this solution will tell me that if there is a region in which particles can only go and do not come back, vice versa, there will be some region from which they come out and they cannot go back. Okay. Again, this is an artifact of imposing a lot of symmetries. At the end, I will explain. Yeah, the reason why we have to talk about this is because we are not done yet. So these coordinates, now we are able. So what is the advantage of these coordinates? That we are now able to follow ingoing time-like paths. Before we are not able because we reached the t equal to plus infinity and we lost control in a sense. We don't know how to continue. Here it's okay, so I go, I cross, I will hit the singularity, but there's no problem in crossing the Schwarzschild radius. But on the other hand, you may be interested in a problem, which maybe is less interesting, to follow geodesics in the past. So you want to know, given a geodesic, let me go back and see where it comes from. And imagine that you follow, so imagine that you have a light ray like going out. Now I see that it comes out and I ask where it comes from. Okay. Then what do? I follow this backwards because it's going out. So and now you see that I have the same problem because now I have to follow the past light cone, okay, which is this. Okay. So I decided to go in the past. So I had to look at the past light cone, but the past light cone, again, it has the same problem that we had at the beginning, because it becomes asymptotic to the horizon in the same way it happened in coordinates. So these coordinates are good to follow things in the future, but they have exactly the original problem when you follow in the past. It's just an artifact, because again, it just tells you that V goes to minus infinity, but you can check that this happens in a finite proper time, so it's just a question that these coordinates, in some sense it's like saying that we were changing a bit coordinates, now we are able to follow some part of the manifold, the one inside the horizon, but inside, in the future, in a sense it's a four-dimensional manifold, so you were able to cover a part of the manifold which correspond to the inside future, so which you can find looking at the ingoing future geodesic, but we still had the problem towards the past. You can do exactly the same algebra using U instead of V. Now U equal to constant means R star equal to time plus a constant. So this means that U equal to constant are outgoing null rays. Okay. So everything flips. Basically, in these coordinates, you would be able to follow geodesics in the past, but if you try to follow it in the future, you have the same problem that we had at the beginning. So let me be brief on this. Also because I told you it's mostly an artifact of our approximation. Okay, so it's the same algebra. I hope there is no, sorry, of course there is something different, there is a minus sign. Nothing, so you can do the same plot. What you get is a bit disturbing, because now the light cone, so now I use U and R as variables. So I always draw the future light cone. So the future light cone is like this. Okay, U equal to constant, and also something which is the analog of the second solution, which goes inside. So when I'm, again, when I'm close, far away from the black hole, I can decide to go either towards the black hole or far from the black hole. This, I'm still free to choose because the icon opens in both directions. Okay, I can go in this, I can go there. As I go closer and closer to the sparse radius, I end up to have an icon like this. Okay. So again, I'm, this in words what I was describing. So in these coordinates, now everything comes out of the black hole, and there is no way to get in. So this is a mathematical algebra. Now it will become a bit more clear when we do the final change of coordinates. Okay. But you should think about this as two different places. So so if you have my manifold, so it's like, think about having a map of a region of the Earth. Okay. So I have a map, then at a certain point I realize that with my ship I reach and okay, there is no map anymore. Okay. So of course now it's a space-time map. Okay. So it depends in which direction I go. So if my if I go towards the horizon in the future, I see that there is a new region, okay, and this region is, I can describe it using these coordinates. If I go close to the black hole, but in the past, it's a different region in my manifold, and it corresponds to this description. Okay, so now we do the last change of coordinates, here. And everything will become super clear.
Okay. Well, why is not that the second the plus sign shouldn't be in line?
Sorry. Sorry, I wanted to.
Ah.
Sorry. Okay. So now I'm going to do one last step, which is basically to have coordinates in which I use both U and V. Actually, I'm going to do two steps. So, okay, using U and V looks smart because you solve both problems, but you don't want to live with coordinates which are both null. Okay, so it's like describing Minkowski space with a coordinate which is the analog of this. I mean, you can do it, but okay, it's a bit... So, basically, we're going to use both, and then to take a linear combination, but after some trick. But, okay, the logic is to use both advantages. So, let me write the metric UV coordinates. It's straightforward, very easy, so I don't do it. I mean, you already know what you should get, because both coordinates are null. This means that du equal to zero and dv equal to zero are both null. So the metric should have this form, because setting this equal to zero, you should get as a result both u equal to constant and v equal to constant. So it must be proportional to this. The cost of proportionality in front, well, you can read it. Okay. Yes, so at a certain point you may be a bit confused because you say, I forget, here there is R. Okay. R, of course, is a function of U and V, but I remind you which step we took. So I want to write, well, first of all, I go back and I say, okay, R is a function of R star. R star is just related to U and V by this. Okay, so let me do it. So 1 half V plus U, minus U, sorry. Minus U. This is R star. And R star is related to R by that formula. So let me, so I can, the point is that I cannot invert this function,
But let me write the following. So I would like to write everything as a function of u and v, but I cannot. I can do something which is in between. So what did I do? Well, I was not able, so we cannot invert this function, but so I basically took the exponential of this, okay? So of course, I'm still left with R and V, but what is relevant is the following, that this prefactor is not singular at the horizon. So at R equal to 2gm, this is completely finite, okay? So this is something that, okay, writing as a function of u and v is a bit complicated, but for sure it's not something that will do anything at the horizon. Okay, so forget about this. Now let's look at this part of the metric. You see what is the problem. The problem is that, for example, let me follow v equal to constant. V equal to constant means that t goes to plus infinity, r star goes to minus infinity, because I'm following in the horizon. But this means that t is equal to plus infinity, r star is equal to minus infinity, so u is blowing up at the horizon. Okay? And the opposite happens for v. But this, you see, it's quite clear from this form of the metric. So the problem is that I have to get rid of these exponentials. Okay? So I can just redefine my variables to reabsorb these exponentials. In this way, so I define big U by just e to the minus u over 4gm, and big V as e to the v over 4gm, yes. I mean, of course, this part becomes very complicated, but I don't care, in a sense, it's regular, I should now write it r as a function of r star, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, okay. So in this way, instead of having this, you will have d big u, d big v, plus times something, well, because there is this, but apart from numerical factors, which comes from this 4gm, you see that this change of coordinates is such that instead of these, you get, instead of these, I apologize, instead of these, I get d big u, d big v. But now it's completely over, because, okay, it's complicated what is in front, but it's completely regular at the horizon, and these is du dv, but now nothing forbids us to go back to the analog of these coordinates. So if you don't like to use null coordinates, I use new time and radial coordinates, which are just u plus v over 2 and u minus v over 2. Okay. And this is our final change of coordinates. Okay, so let me write here, the final thing. So the final thing is to write, as I said, t is equal to big U plus big V over 2. I call it X instead of R, because I don't have which is big V minus big U over 2. And the metric I write the metric. The metric is the following.
So I don't know why I'm switching between R and let me use big R. Both. I don't know. I'm using both. Okay. So this is called
Sekeres coordinates.
I mean, it's very simple. It's very simple in the sense that this is nothing more than Minkowski times something. Of course, you know, there is some complication which is hidden because here you still have the small radius. So if I have to write the small radius as a function of t and r, it's a mess. Now I do it. Right. Because there are many steps. I have to go back to big U and big V, then to small u and small v, then to r star, and then to r star to r. Okay. But we don't care so much about this because everything is regular. So nothing happens at r, it becomes a constant. So, you know, if you want to know what is this constant, if you want to study details, you need, but the fact that this is nothing more than Minkowski space times a constant is pretty clear. Yes, so let me give you the relation between the final variables and the original ones. And then we just draw what these coordinates tell us. This is the relation between the new final Kruskal-Sekeres coordinates and the original radius and the original t. Actually, I'm a bit cheating. You can find the correct expression in the formula. So these are is the expression which is valid for r larger than 2gm. For r smaller than 2gm, there are some flip of signs, but we don't really care. Okay, so let me draw okay, now we spend a bit of time and this is the last thing to see what we can read from this. Okay. First of all, we draw the axis. This is already good. Okay. Now it's nice to know what are the lines of constant original R, because the original R is still what I suppress the two sphere, but the two sphere is there and it has radius given by the small r. So it's good to know what is the small r. Well, to get rid of t, I can take cosh squared minus sin squared. So t squared minus r squared big is equal to 1 minus r over 2gm times e to the r over 2gm. Okay? So, lines of constant radius are hyperbole in this plane. Let me draw, for example. So, first of all, let's look at the horizon. But maybe it's not the easiest thing. So, for large radii which are far from the Schwarzschild radius, so this is positive. Okay. So this is should be negative. Sorry, I'm a bit confused. So it's this square. So it's negative. Sorry. For large radii, I put this. So for large radii, this is negative. For radii which are much larger than the Schwarzschild radius. So this negative, so it corresponds to hyperbole like this. So if this is something like this. Okay. So what it means is that to stay, if I want to have somebody who is staying at fixed radius in the original coordinates, like us on the Earth, they are moving in this diagram in this way. Okay. So they are moving. Of course, in these coordinates, the light cone is straightforward. No, the light cone is 45 degrees because the metric is just this. So moving in a time-like direction means that you have to move inside the light cone like this. Okay. So this is a time-like motion. Does not correspond to constant r, but okay, because this is correspond to constant small r. So this is a line in which the surface of a sphere is constant. Let me also look at what time is doing. Well, time, I can take ratio t over r. This cancel with this, and I get the hyperbolic tangent of t over 4 gm. Okay, so now we understand a bit more, because you see, as time goes on, you move, so imagine that you stay at fixed r, so as time goes on, you move, okay, because lines of constant time are like this, okay, time equal to constant. Okay, so lines of constant small r, lines of constant small t. But you see what happens, and this was, when the time goes to infinity, you said that the hyperbolic tangent goes to 1. So this, in this diagram, this 45 degrees line is also called t equal to infinity. Mm-hmm. That's why in the original coordinates, to go through the horizon, you go to t equal to plus infinity. But from this point of view, it's just because you were silly and you decided to choose coordinates such that this line corresponds to t equal to plus infinity.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Why these lines are the t is equal to constant?
Yes, because I took these. So if I take the ratio between these,
yeah.
R goes away.
Yeah.
Okay. So this means that the time fixes on which line. So if I fix t, I live on. So if as time evolves, it means that the ratio between t and r is changing. Okay.
Yeah.
So it's
the slope is changing.
Yeah. So it's. It's so for a fixed time, it means that there is a fixed slope between t and r. Yes. If I fix varying time, it means varying the slope of these lines.
Yes, yes.
But it's important that it only holds until t equal to plus infinity when yes. you reach the horizon. Okay. Why it is the horizon? Because, sorry, I didn't say, but r equal to 2gm correspond to the degenerate hyperbola t equal to plus or minus r. So this is the horizon. Now I will come back to. So actually, everything is symmetric. So also, this is the horizon. So this is the horizon. Okay. Of course, you start seeing that. First of all, let's look at the singularity. The singularity is r equal to zero. R equal to zero correspond to t minus r squared equal to 1, which is this hyperbole. So this is really a singularity. So the Riemann square diverges here. So here, when you reach this, I don't know what happens here.
What? How did you get this line?
This is the line which in the original geometry, so you remember, apart from the interpretation, we checked that the Riemann squared diverges at small r equal to 0,
yes.
because it's something that goes like 1 over r to the 6. So this means that we said that there is a singularity there, meaning that the Riemann diverges. R = 0 means that this is equal to 1,
yeah.
So it corresponds to this equation.
Yeah.
So this is this. Sorry. I apologize. This was the so this is the horizon. I apologize. The singularity is t squared minus r squared equal to 1, which is this epergola. Okay, so now I'm going to describe what happens here. But here it's pretty clear, no? So here you are happy, you are far from the black hole. Okay, you are using a bit strange coordinates, but everything is fine. So time, if you move in the time-like direction, t increases. If you go far away, r increases. But the constant r is just this. But going far away, you go to larger, big r. So you also understand that if you cross this line, first of all, you understand that the original time goes to plus infinity, but this is just a stupid choice of coordinates. In a sense, you decide to give this strange name to this line. This is your problem. On the other hand, and this is important, because the way I'm saying this, it seems that nothing happens at the horizon. I mean, it is true that nothing happens in the sense I don't stop there, I can cross it, I don't see anything. It's not singular, the geometry, because we check the Riemann is finite. You reach this in a finite proper time, nothing happens. But something happens in some sense, because once you cross this line, you see that your future is the singularity. There is no way to escape from infinity. Because from this diagram, infinity means there, in the sense, while your future like or now is the singularity.
Yes.
Okay. So it's not that something happens, it's like a global concept, in a sense, once you cross that line, then you will not never be able to reach to infinity anymore, because your future is the singularity. In some sense, you see, from the, when you are inside the horizon, you should, it's really like a time-dependent geometry. So it's like when you are inside, first of all, so since the radius is now a time variable, you should think a bit like saying that you are living in some time-dependent geometry, which is crunching. So in the sense, in your future, you will have a singularity. Okay? It's like a bit like a cosmology in which in the future you have a singularity. So that's why from the beginning I told you there is no center of this geometry, because the point r equal to zero is this line, which is some sort of future thing of this geometry. Okay, let me conclude talking about the rest of the diagram. Okay, everything, again, it's an artifact of our symmetry, but everything is time reverse symmetric. So if you have this line, you also have this line, which is the other solution. Okay, so again, here there is a singularity. And again, here there is what is called a white hole. But again, it's just a consequence of our approximation. So a white hole, you see, things can only go out of the horizon, they cannot go in, okay? The same way as that. So it's just the same physics, but time reversed. How should I look at this diagram for a more physical point of view? Well, if, of course, this is a solution of general relativity, so in principle, I mean, if I don't know about the history of the universe, I mean, I don't know, this is a solution, so from our point of view, it could be there. On the other hand, if I think about a physical, astrophysical black holes, which form at a certain point, well, you should think about it as a star that implodes to become smaller than the Schwarzschild radius. Okay, let me draw the surface of this star. Well, early on, I mean, basically the surface of the star will draw on this diagram a time-like curve. Okay. So let me draw it like this, for example. Okay. So this tells you the following, that if I'm here, the radius of, so I can trust this geometry only outside this line, because inside this line, we are inside the star, and then the Schwarzschild geometry does not apply. So I should always look at only what is on this side. So here, there is no horizon, so I cannot trust, I cannot go to see the horizon. But once, at a certain point, the surface of the star crosses the horizon. So this tells me that all this geometry, I should not consider it. I mean, it's nice, in physics it's still useful for many purposes, more theoretical, to have the full geometry, and so on and so forth. But if I focus on about astrophysical black holes, so it's only this part of the geometry which is reliable, which still tells you that there is a black hole. There is, once the black hole formed, so there is an horizon, and now after that, if I fall inside the black hole, I have the same physics. I cannot escape to infinity. My future is the singularity, okay? But all the rest, this white hole, and also this part of the diagram, is not there. There is also, I mean, just to tell you, this solution is called also maximal extension of the Schwarzschild solution. Maximal extension is that it's a solution such that every possible geodesic, every possible path basically, can be followed for infinite affine parameter. So there is no other region. So if I take a geodesics and I follow it in the past and in the future, either it hits the singularity, and there I cannot do anything else, or I can follow it to infinite affine parameter. This was not the case in the original coordinates, because I couldn't follow some of the path for infinite affine parameter, but I can do it here. In this geometry, there is also a strange region, which is this one, which is a copy, again, it's a figment of our approximation, but in this geometry, there is another asymptotic region, which is Minkowskian, here. It's the same as this. Notice that, so each point here is a two-sphere. So in this region is really a different, it's not the same asymptotic region, it's a different asymptotic region. Of course, if I live in this asymptotic region, I cannot communicate with this other asymptotic region. Both they can communicate to the inside horizon, but I cannot send a signal from this wedge to this wedge. So they are causally disconnected. People talk about, this connection is sometimes called an Einstein-Rosen bridge. So it's a bridge in the sense that so you need some space-like path to connect. Okay. So one way to see this geometry is also to think about two optic regions which are connected by a wormhole, which is just something which connect the two geometry, but it's space-like, so I cannot traverse it as a time-like observer. I say this because this geometry, although the physically interesting part is this one, the full geometry is still interesting in many cases. For example, if you study, the SCFT, sometimes the full geometry, at least theoretically, we are not interested in astrophysical black holes, but this is a GR solution. So, if you think that a GR solution is dual to a conformality theory in some theories, this must hold for the full geometry. So you don't care that this black hole does not exist, this white hole does not exist in nature. You just care about the full solution. Okay? So sometimes the full solution is. Are you sufficiently confused for the weekend? No, I mean, it's confusing. It's some things are confusing, but you should not be surprised. So this this change of final change of coding was done in 1965. So it's not that people immediately understood what's going on. No? So usually you listen to these things and after a lot of processing, so everything is solved like it is trivial. When I mean, it's, and things are not completely trivial. So Einstein, for a long time, didn't think that gravitational waves existed. So he wrote papers about the fact that they do not exist. Weinberg, if you take his book, does not really believe in black holes. So in fact, there is a very limited discussion about black holes in this book. So you know, just to say that it's not that you should not be afraid of seeing something which is a bit disturbing, and because I mean, people were confused for a long time. Okay, so you have 1 week to think about.
What exactly is the problem with it? What happens at the singularity?
We don't know. The singularity, the only thing that we know is that the Riemann diverges here. So it's really a curvature singularity, so which means that general relativity will not hold sufficiently close to the singularity. Unfortunately, not much progress. I mean, as far as I know, there is no resolution of the singularity, even in string theory, for example. Other kind of singularity, because in principle, you can say, okay, if I have a theory which proclaims to be the full quantum gravity, I should be able to solve this in PS, but then technically, the problem here is that it's a time-dependent solution, okay? Because I mean, from the outside it doesn't seem, but the inside it's time dependent. Yeah, let me mention this. Notice how it worked. So we were trying to impose the fact that the solution is time independent, and in fact it is independent of t. But this symmetry inside this region is not a translation in time, no? Okay. This metric is really time dependent. If you live inside here, I mean, technically, the killing vector is not time-like. So it's it changes nature here. This to say that since it is a time dependent problem, it's very complicated even in string theory. So, for example, you cannot use supersymmetry because of the time dependence. Anyway, I don't know too much, but just to say that one believes that quantum gravity effect will become relevant, but for this kind of singularities, I don't think we know what happens here. Although, again, for the purposes of what happens outside, this is not relevant in the sense that it does not affect.
Couldn't it be astrophysical black holes don't follow this solution. Couldn't this solution exactly? So couldn't there be some astrophysical, like physical, something that prevents you from reaching the singularity anyway? That's not in the spherical solution.
Could be. Let me just. I'm not sure if you're talking about the singularity, not the formation of.
Yes.
I have to say for all again. For all purposes, meaning, for example, for all the observations that we do with black holes, the physics of the singularity is completely shielded. So, I mean, we cannot use this kind of experiments to tell me something about what is inside this joint.
But I don't know if there is black hole. This is still like something compact object. Then, in some sense, you cannot get into the singularity because I mean there is matter that have to cross before getting into the singularity. So and then when you face matter, then you have to use another solution for the metric.
True.
The end is like the singularity maybe changes when you actually work in the not vacuum Einstein.
Well, there are. So, for example, you may try to say the following. which is what we are suggesting, that maybe once you study the full solution, including matter, maybe there is no singularity, mm-hmm. but this is not the case. So, mm-hmm. So for example, these Hawking-Penrose theorems, so there are theorems, mm-hmm. Because people, what happened more or less is that, okay, you find solutions, and some solutions, they are singularity. For example, another singularity that you will find, that when you study cosmology, you will have some singularity, like Big Bang or singularity. But people start this debating whether, okay, even in Newtonian, so it could be just an artifact of the fact that you are simplifying the problem too much, like in this case, okay? Mm-hmm. Then people came out with full proofs that whatever you do under some condition, and in this case it applies, a singularity must form. Okay? Mm-hmm. So there is, maybe it's not, maybe the solution is not this. Also, you may say, okay, if I have some, any astrophysical black hole will not be exactly spherically symmetric, so maybe at the center, mm-hmm. since it's, I mean, you may think, okay, maybe it's an artifact of the fact that I impose perfect spherical symmetry, so it's like saying that there is a shell which collapses at one point exactly, but once you put some deformation, this will not happen at the same time. So people were debating whether the full solution is still singular or not, but I mean, there are theorems which, under some condition, prove that at least at one point there is a singularity. So there is a singularity. So there is somewhere in the geometry, the
because, like in Newton's, when you are like in the center, it's mm-hmm. not like gravity, because like everything, like the mass is, everything is around you, so at the end you don't feel nothing at the center. I don't know.
I agree, yeah, I agree. But in fact, this is I think the reason why people were interested in these theorems, because still, here the theory is so complicated that you cannot hope to solve Einstein's equation in a generic situation. So the fact that you are able to prove that no matter how things go, there is a singularity was important. No, it's not just because you may think that sometimes singularity are just a consequence of you are using too much symmetry, but it's mm-hmm. not the case, unfortunately. Mm-hmm.
What happens to a star after it shrinks to a black hole? I mean, you have the beyond the surface of a black hole, you would have the Schwarzschild solution, but couldn't you have the, what he's saying, that you have the surface of a black hole and then maybe a star inside, and then you have to here that you have to use Schwarzschild, but then after you hit the star, you have to use the other solution.
Maybe, well, let me mention that, you know, for a particle here, in a finite proper time reaches the singularity. So you should not think that there is something static inside the black hole. In a sense, this is a fully dynamical geometry. In a sense, you should think about something which is crashing in time. So if you are inside in a finite proper time, you reach the singularity. So, no, but again, these are all good questions. In a sense, what we know is that a singularity exists, so maybe it's not even giving up with some symmetry. You should not think, so notice that, if you think about it, so this geometry is completely different from the intuition that you have, no? So it's, so radius is now time, so you should not think that there is. So first of all, the horizon is null. So it's not a surface of constant radius. It's a null place, and inside that the radius is a time variable. So there are no solutions with some. You may think that there is something inside there, and it's not possible because this is time dependent.
I'm also confused. I got confused already. When people say we should use fine for quantum gravity, they say
we should use it?
For quantum gravity, what is the scale that tells us? Because I'm confused, because radius turns into time, like into time. So we cannot say that, you know, it's because the radius is very small that we should use quantum mechanics. What is the scale that tells us that we should look for
the fact that the Riemann square becomes larger than the Planck scale, no? So forget about coordinate independence. So there are diff invariant quantities which are blowing up.
Yeah. But what is the quantum part? Quantum.
Well, quantum because let me put it this way. For sure, for example, if you calculate the graviton-graviton scattering from the Einstein-Hilbert action, this becomes strongly coupled with the Planck scale, which is exactly what happens in the Fermi theory. So it tells you that this theory must be UV-completed. So it cannot be a complete theory for scales of energy smaller than the Planck, larger than the Planck scale. So there is something else. The calculation that you do doesn't make any sense. So there must be something else. And now, the question is when this something else will show up. Well, it will show up for sure before reaching the regime in which the answer you get from perturbation theory does not make any sense anymore. So this is the Planck scale. So once the curvature reaches these regimes, there is no reason to... Now, I mean, I don't know, given that we don't really know what happens, it's a bit of words, but... let me approach it perturbatively. So the Einstein-Hilbert action will be supplemented by higher dimension operators like Riemann squared over a certain scale.
Yeah.
Now, this scale cannot be higher than the Planck scale because it's a non-normalizable theory. So these operators are generated. So they are there.
Uh-huh.
They become relevant because they are Riemann squared. They are one more power of Riemann over M Planck. So they become relevant when you approach the singularity. Now, of course, once you approach really the singularity, all operators become important. The theory will take another form, and we don't know what happens. But this is the rationale why we cannot trust this solution.
Okay. So it's the
What happens to the matter that made the star after it collapses into the black hole?
It's there.
Is it still a star or is it
we don't know. Well, for sure I don't know. We don't know. And I don't know if it is of course not affect anything that we can measure, so it's not that people study this so much. So I think the picture is that you can continue this it will be crunched with singularity.
But it leaves the black hole in a sense eventually, no, because of Hawking radiation.
Yeah, this is much more subtle, and it goes beyond. So here everything is classical, and it's already pretty complicated. So I suggest not to think much about Hawking radiation. Here already the classical level is pretty complicated. So anyway. It's an important theoretical question. Of course, Hawking radiation is zero for astrophysical black holes, so it's not an effect which... in a sense, if you're interested in astrophysical black holes, the Hawking radiation is completely negligible. If you're interested in more theoretical questions, it's interesting, but still... usually, when you're interested in more theoretical questions, you think about the geometry like this. Not formed by infalling matter. Okay, guys, I'll see you in 10 days.
Okay.